So let me frame this before we begin. Who here has heard of a study? There was a study that came out in 2007 by two Harvard psychologists named Dan Gilbert and Matthew Killingsworth. And this was a couple people. Matthew Killingsworth at the time was his postdoc. And what they did was they created an iPhone app. And on this iPhone app, what they did was they pinged people to find out where people's minds were. Were they on what they had intended it to be on and all that kind of stuff. So some of you have heard about this? A few people? Okay. So yeah, I think you could still get the iPhone app if you want to kind of play around with it, if you have an iPhone. I don't have an iPhone, but if you have that, you can play with it. Maybe it's available on Android now. Or BlackBerry. for those of you who are left with BlackBerry. Anyways, basically what it is what they found, the results were, is that people's minds wander about 47% of the time. So 47% of the time, our minds are off. So those of you in your classrooms in Antioch, or you're coming from your jobs or whatever, you know you're trying to pay attention, but your minds are off. Some people here might say 47% of the time, wow, that sounds like a lot. I'm really good at paying attention. Other people might say, that sounds like nothing. My mind is like off in the class more of the time than that. And so the interesting finding of that, for those of you familiar with it, is that the mind wanders only 10% of the time when we're having sex. So, but that's not a way to pay attention here. So we're not going to do that in this group while we're doing this. The point of that is this. This whole talk today is an awareness practice. This whole talk for you today is an awareness practice. Mindfulness, we'll talk a little bit about that, is about paying attention to something on purpose, basically. And so here the object is this talk. Here, rather than what's classically maybe known as the breath or the body or something like that. And what's going to happen is you can count on it, per research, statistical thing that we've learned, your mind is going to go off at times. And so it's going to go off thinking about what you need to do later, or what you had to do in the past, or maybe a memory, a dream, a fantasy, who knows. And so when you become aware of it, just notice that you're aware. That's perfectly fine. And in that moment you're awake, you're sitting in what's called a choice point. And so here we have the opportunity to exercise becoming more aware of choices and bringing our attention back to whatever we're intending to bring our attention back to. So here's what I just want you to do. I want you to, when your mind wanders, I just want you to spend a moment with it. Don't worry about what I'm talking about. Just spend a moment with it and touch it if you can, almost like with your mind. Just spend a moment. Was it something important? Maybe you want to write it down. And then very gently guide your attention back to being here. Because one thing we know about how the brain works is that what you intentionally practice and repeat, that's what kind of grows those neural pathways. That's what makes things automatic, in other words. And so we're just noticing and become more aware of choices and gently bringing our attention back. So being more gentle with ourselves and being more aware of choices. What would life be like in the days and weeks and months ahead if we had more awareness around the various choices that are around with us and we were more gentle with ourselves and we kind of wandered off from our intentions? Maybe a little lighter. That's the first thing. So that's what we're going to do. Now, once in a while during this talk, you're going to hear this bell. It kind of reminds me of like elementary school or something. This bell. And that's just going to be the bell to say, where's your mind? So you don't have to do this by yourself. I'm going to help you out with it. And so where's your mind? And you just might make note of it. Okay. So that's the overview. So here we have to ask the question initially, why do people come to, say, psychotherapy or healthcare professionals at all in general? Why do people come? Why do we go? Why do people come? Anyone have any ideas of why psychotherapy, why people even come to that? Well, it's called psychotherapy in general right now, but yeah.
They're in pain.
They're in pain. Okay, there's some kind of pain. Okay, what else? Yeah.
Increased awareness.
Okay. All right. Need some guidance because they feel stuck. Okay, we're going to ask this in form of a Jeopardy question now. What is stress, anxiety, depression, addiction, and trauma? One woman here said pain. What else? What is it? What's stress, anxiety, depression, addiction, and trauma? What is it? Life. Someone said life? Okay. Fear? Fear is involved in it? Okay. Yep. Emotions or feelings. So I'm going to kind of combine you two over there and say emotional pain, emotional suffering. People come to seek help because they're in some form of emotional suffering. These are all forms of emotion. Now stress, What I mean by that is negative stress. Certainly, certain parts of stress are positive. It helps us be motivated and stuff like that. There's something called a York-Dobson curve, which those of you have heard of that, is stress is really good up to a point, and then it kind of hits a pinnacle, and then it becomes depleting. And we could talk about how that works physiologically in the body and the brain, and over time how that shortens our lifespan as well. Okay, so emotional suffering. People come to psychotherapy because of emotional suffering. So the question is, how does that emotional suffering work? So there's two different things. We have a culprit here, and it's inside this coconut shell, you know, right here. And the culprit is our brain. Our brain is wired to maintain emotional suffering in some way. Why? Because when it's wired to perceive anything in the present moment, it has to reach back into the past to try and figure it out, referencing our past experiences, our emotional experiences, and it has to then shoot into the future to anticipate anything that might be coming up. That's to keep us safe. And so it does this. The brain kind of does this, and what happens is when we have some form of emotional suffering, some kind of stress that's there, what it's wired to do is stay away from that stress. We don't put our hand in the fire and say, oh, something about this just feels really good. I'm going to just stay right here. You know, we immediately, instinctively, move back. And the same thing happens with our emotions. The problem with that is, when it comes to emotional difficulty, and those of you psychotherapists in the room kind of have a sense of that, the problem with that is it goes into this problem-solving mode to try and figure out ways to kind of get away from this. And it uses old coping strategies from the time we were young, maybe, or maybe it just kind of ruminates to figure it out. Does anybody know why a mouse goes limp in a cat's mouth? A freeze response. Okay, so there's a freeze, but why? Why does it go into the freeze response? What's the reason for that? A survival method? Well, it's not going to survive. There are. She said if the cat, because maybe the cat will think it's dead and the cat won't be as alert, so it has a chance to escape. Maybe, possibly. Physiological numbing to block the pain. Yeah. Physiological numbing to block the pain. What's depression? Physiological numbing to block the pain. So, you know, the body's doing what it needs to do. There's an overwhelm of emotional suffering in that moment. And so the body goes into this numbing type of place. So, you know, there's certain ways that we cope. One is by thinking and trying to figure it out. There's other physiological reasons that are kind of automatic numbing that go on. And so the idea is, how do we want to kind of move into not the automatic type of avoidance state of things, which maintain emotional suffering. But what we want to do is find out, how do we actually heal this pain? I think it was Mark Twain that said, there's so many problems I've had in this life, most of which never happened. Something like that. Had so many problems in this life, most of which never happened. Something like that. So that's the question. Our number one bad habit that we have to maintain emotional suffering isn't drugs and alcohol or, the new one, right? A new kind of like checking, which, by the way, this is fascinating. Learning our relationship to this, something I'm going to be diving into more in the future, because it's just kind of fascinating. There's great references out there into how this actually helps us and how it maintains emotional suffering. But here's the question: how do we change our relationship to the difficulties that are there? How do we do it? I think one of the things that we've found is we do it through one of the things that we do is by increasing awareness. And that's just, and one of the, what's the definition of mindfulness? So this kind of gets into, so what is mindfulness? Anybody have any ideas? Who here has practiced mindfulness? There's a number of people, and some people are new to it. So let's get some answers. What is mindfulness? Attending to one thing at a time. Okay, what else? Yeah. Bringing attention to the moment, yeah. Oh, I love that. Yeah. You're touching on the very simple principle upon which the now effect is based on. Yeah. So So that space, yeah. What else? Yep. Ah, coming to your senses. Coming to your senses is a way to kind of reground yourself. Anybody else? Any other ones? Yeah. She said, just paying, again, paying attention to your senses. One example of that is washing the dishes, being in the shower, these types of things. Okay, so I'll give you two definitions of mindfulness. Mindfulness can be thought of as a noun, and it can be thought of as a verb. The noun in and of itself is just awareness. That's all it is. If you're sitting in a space of awareness, you're being mindful. Like, you're aware of what's happening as it's happening. For example, washing the dishes. Or just noticing what's on your mind, or whatever. Noticing an emotion that's there. You're being mindful of it. But there's a verb to mindfulness, too. It's not just a noun. The verb is intentionally paying attention to the here and now, what's happening, while putting aside our program biases. So one of the things that we said that maintains emotional suffering is those programmed biases of this is good or bad, or right or wrong, that immediately come from the brain, that snap faster than we can think, because they're coming from the subcortical regions of our brain, which are very fast. Trauma-related ones that are even deeper, or maybe young coping strategies that aren't really kind of sitting at the front of our conscious awareness, are influencing the way we're relating to anything in the present moment. Our stress, anxiety, depression, these types of things that are kind of popping up. Different relationships, difficult relationships. And so one of the things that we're doing with mindfulness, we're trying to train the brain to take a step back and kind of reevaluate what's going on from a fresh perspective. And maybe say, what's actually skillful in this moment? So in psychotherapy, we talk a lot about, you know, these are all coping strategies. They might not be that helpful nowadays. You know, they may be helpful when we were young. You know, maybe hiding in your closet from your parents who were, you know, running around and trying to beat you or whatever was a healthy coping strategy back then. But now kind of hiding in the closet isn't quite as good. I'll give you a personal example. When I was young, my parents got divorced, and I was pretty pissed off. And I had no idea how to process that, though. I was 6 years old, no idea how to process that. And I tried to glom onto something to be angry about. Because I didn't want to be angry just at my parents, or who knows, I just wasn't clear on it. So I decided I'm going to be angry about our financial situation. And I'm going to really try and think and imagine that I know our financial situation, and I'm going to be really pissed off that we're spending any money on anything because we didn't have any money, in my mind. And so every time my dad, who worked day and oftentimes into the evening, didn't have time to prepare dinner sometimes, we'd go out to dinner, I would hide under the table. I would go out, wherever we went out to dinner, I would sit under the table and protest, totally pissed off, being willful, and I wouldn't eat my dinner. And so later on in life, that was a coping strategy for me to kind of deal with my anger in some way. Later on in life, I had a very similar situation. I was, besides those of you who read my book and see that I had like a past history of substance abuse in a way of kind of avoiding, you know, life in some ways. Later on, when I met my wife, we were walking on the beach, and she would react with anger, and I would just kind of shut down. I would completely shut down. And then in therapy, I was in therapy one day, and my therapist said, "It seems to me like you're still hiding under the table." And in that moment, it just kind of clicked for me that I was using my brain. I wasn't aware this was happening. My brain was using an old coping strategy to be able to deal with something that was aversive to me, which was anger, because anger as a kid became overwhelming to me at some point because I wasn't able to kind of deal with it. And so I wasn't that good at just kind of being aware of my anger. So for me, mindfulness allowed me to touch into the subtle sensations of anger and be able to use it in a constructive way, to be able to be more assertive, and sometimes it comes out with a telephone company if I see an overbilling or something like that. Somehow I feel comfortable in expressing my anger, you know, across a phone or something. But so we're using new ways to relate to our experience. For many of our clients, it's completely foreign, and even for us in the room, it's completely foreign to be able to be aware of emotion. And it's classic in psychotherapy. How are you feeling, right? And anybody that even doesn't even like psychotherapy or has no idea what it is, say, "Oh, how are you feeling?" You know, but really, what feeling is here right now? And can we allow ourselves to attune to it? For a long time in psychotherapy, that's what we've been doing with our clients. Mindfulness allows a specific skill of deepening. It gives, I think, therapists and ourselves a very practical and systematic way to actually help clients attune to themselves in a particular way without the judgments that are there. If judgments arise, with the awareness that that's just going to happen, but we allow ourselves to dip into the very essence of what's happening in this moment. So we're going to do a very short practice right now. This is going to be a very short practice, and this is a practice that it's in the Now Effect. It's also in the MBSR workbook, but it's a practice that's a short practice that, for those of you who say, how do I introduce mindfulness to my clients? Mindfulness is best done. There's a few different ways we can introduce it. One is just by using it ourselves and allowing ourselves to become more present. The greatest factor we have in influencing therapy with clients is our presence. That's an outcome study that happened in 1992 by Michael Lambert and others, who said, you know, certain factors are fixed. Genders, people, what people are coming in with, the placebo, whether they believe this is going to work or not, that's like 70%. 30% is our presence, our ability to attune to the person. That's what we have control over. So using mindfulness just as on our own, for our own self-care, or for the ability to deepen our ability to be present, can actually affect the therapy. So let's do this. This is a short practice. I'm going to tell you what it is. Some of you have experience with it. If you do, one of the elements of mindfulness is beginner's mind, being able to notice something as if for the very first time. So it's a four-step practice. And it's just, we're just going to stop. We're going to take a few deep breaths. So we're not going to do any kind of long breathing practice, nothing like that. And which is aversive maybe to people who don't, or our clients who don't have or aren't interested in that. And we're just going to observe our experience in the moment. And we're going to do it through three steps. And I'll bring you through this. And then we're going to proceed. That's it. So go ahead and just, I'm going to invite you to gently close your eyes. And always with any instruction with anybody, you want to invite them to close their eyes, but you also want to give them an out. If they don't want to close their eyes, which this is an instruction to you, just keep a dull gaze towards your desk in front of you. Which is fine. You can keep them open. Just a gaze towards your desk. So we're just stopping what we're doing. And we're taking a few deep breaths. So breathing in, allowing it to be deep, breathing out. And for the next couple breaths, as you take the deep breath in, just say to yourself in. Take the deep breath out, just say to yourself out. And now, getting a sense of your body sitting here. Noticing the positioning of your body. Being aware of your feet connected to the floor. Your body connected to the chair. And also getting a sense of, in this body right now, if there's any tension or tightness anywhere. And if there is, in the shoulders, the back, anywhere, then you can allow it to soften. Just make the choice to do so. Also in this moment, noticing your emotional experience. Where are you starting this moment from emotionally? If there's a sense of calm or annoyance or irritation or restlessness. Maybe it's a neutral feeling or some energy that doesn't have a name. And being aware of your thoughts. Is your mind busy and distracted? Or does it seem calm and focused? And all of that is without any judgment. It just matters that you're aware of it. It doesn't matter what direction it's going in. And we're going to proceed by just asking ourselves, what really matters to pay attention to right now? And seeing what comes up for you. And then gently letting the light seep through, opening the eyes. Okay, so that was like a 2-minute practice. What did you notice? What did you notice in doing that? Just the facts. What were you aware of in your body, your mind, here or there?
Tension.
Tension in your shoulder? Uh-huh. Were you able to allow it to soften?
Yes, but before you said it, I really wasn't aware of it. Mm-hmm. And then when you said it, it's like, oh, yeah. So yes, I was able to.
So our body, there's wisdom in our body. And there's also, our body carries, is our storehouse for emotions, thoughts, and feelings. And so what would it be like if in the minutes or hours or days that are ahead of us, if we had more awareness of that when it was there and were sat in a choice point of allowing it to soften? What would be different around anxiety, around various things? Okay, what else? What else did you notice? Anybody else? Yeah. And when you said hunger, I wouldn't have noticed until it was much larger, she said. Were you aware of how that hunger felt in your body? Where? In the stomach area. It's a little empty. Maybe the body needs some nourishment. Yeah. What else? Anything else? Yeah. My mind was still at work. And what happened when you noticed that? So the wanting to come back here. Okay. So we have to, there's a great quote by, which is the quote that the now effect is based, on a very simple premise. It's a very simple quote by a Holocaust survivor, neurologist, psychiatrist. Many of you in this room have heard this quote before. And the quote is, between stimulus and response, there's a space. In that space lies our power to choose our response. In our response lies our growth and our freedom. Between stimulus and response, there's a space. In that space lies our power to choose our response. In our response lies our growth and our freedom. Oftentimes in the moment when it comes to stress, anxiety, depression, trauma, there's no awareness of that space. That space is gone, long gone, because that awareness of that space comes from this area of our brain, which is, as many of you may know, is the most evolved area of our brain, what separates us from most mammals out there, this prefrontal cortex. And to be able to be conscious and be able to pay attention to what's actually happening means that we're sitting in the space. So mindfulness, what it allows us to do is it allows us to widen that space between the stimulus and response. We're literally training our brains. Remember, our brains grow in the direction of whatever is practiced and repeated. That's it. So we learn how to walk by doing that. We learn how to talk by doing that. We learn how to learn what objects are. I know that's a camera right there. Hi, everyone. Because my brain sees that, it references all my learning from it and spits out immediately what that is. And so it does the same thing with the way that we're relating to our everyday lives. So we can train our brains to widen that space between the stimulus and response so that we can get more in touch with what's in that space. What's in that space is choice, opportunity, possibility to do things differently, relate to our experiences differently, and also a sense of freedom from the enslavement that's going on by our automatic firings of the way that we're relating to something. And so, yeah, go ahead. Yeah, she says, why do we have to come to a class like this or go to therapy? How come this doesn't come to us naturally to be able to just be present and be able to choose an adaptive response to things? And there's a few different reasons for that. One is, well, we can look at many reasons, but the fundamental one is biological. From an evolutionary perspective, the people who were sitting around back in the, thousands of years ago, sitting around and kind of looking at the blades of grass and saying, like, this is beautiful here, out in the middle of the Serengeti or the forest, where this is beautiful. Let's all just sit here and meditate together. Well, those people weren't aware of the dangers around them, so they didn't really survive. So, they didn't pass on their genes to us. We're not a product of those people. We're a product of the people that were going around like this. you know, looking like this, and really wired towards the danger and the fear that was there. And so that's one reason. So our brains are, you can say, thousands and thousands of years of mastery in paying attention to negative stuff, because that's what keeps us safe. And so we don't want to have to think when we're walking past a dark alleyway and you see a shiny blade flipping around in the thing that, what should I do here? Should I go this way or that way? It's immediately, it's an instinct. I feel this, that I'm going to stay away from that. That's because that's firing in a deeper portion of our brain, the amygdala, which is the fear circuit of the brain, which is which moves a lot faster as we move up the various structures of our brain. My friend, and many of you have heard of him, being at Antioch, Dan Siegel, has a great, very generalized model of the brain. Who here has heard of his hand model? A few people? A number of people. Okay, so I'll just quickly run through it. So, you know, here's our kind of more lower structures of our brain, our more primitive lizard brain, fight or flight response. You see a lizard. Lizards are kind of moving really fast, or they're freezing. A lot of times they're not moving at all. And that's kind of the lower structures of our brain. As you move up, this is our limbic structure, our emotional system. And so this is this part that has to do with all of our emotions, including our amygdala, the fear circuit. By the way, in people who are depressed, the amygdala is really enlarged because it's constant. It probably gets more work about, you know, being protective around things. And then as you this flap over here is our evolved area. This is our cortex that wraps around the emotional center and connects with the lower structures as well. And this part in front of our thumb here is the prefrontal cortex, which is what is reserved for human beings and a few different animals. And what happens is when you are in an emotional place, when you're dealing with trauma around, let's say, incarcerated youth, for example, or just other trauma in our lives, the VA, people who are coming back, or different types of trauma, we literally, what he says, which is just kind of a funny way of saying this, is we literally flip our lids. And so what we're doing is we're reacting from this emotional center constantly. And so we're not able to access, there's less blood flow going on in the prefrontal cortex, which is more involved with our rational brain. It's more of our decision making, as a generalization, by the way, more involved with our decision making about what's the best thing for me to, what's the most consciously best thing for me to do here. And so we're just kind of reacting constantly. And it's not that there's a lot of go ahead. Well, with your population, she said, with my population, which is incarcerated youth, which there's a lot of work being done with incarcerated youth right now. So youth are also, by the way, there's an openness sometimes to them, to learning new experiences. She said, will it be more difficult to teach mindfulness to them? And I say it depends. The adolescence is the time where the brain is pruning too. So it's kind of pruning away the structures that are not being used so much, and really digging in and creating stronger structures about the things that are actually being practiced and repeated and seen, a time to kind of form the basis of the brain. Now, obviously, we know in the past 10 years, or 15 years now, that the brain has plasticity over the lifespan, and we can grow new areas of the brain through a variety of different things, and one including mindfulness, other exercise. We can do it by being a London cab driver and learning routes all the time, or we can do it by playing piano, or even visualizing playing piano, or visualizing things can grow certain areas of the brain. Doesn't matter how old you are, which is a real plus for those people who do visualization in their therapy here. People who are practicing, repeating that over time are likely creating new neural structures depending on what the visualization is. So when it comes to trauma, for example, if you don't. The idea isn't to put someone back in the traumatic environment or put them in face with it. We're slowly kind of conditioning a matching that's going on between an idea around the trauma and their emotional response, and slowly pairing a new relationship with it, so that our nervous system gets the understanding that this isn't something that I need to fear so much right now. Or if this is in my environment, I need to be skillful and take precaution or change my environment in some way. Yeah. Right. So, you know, you touched on the second part, which is around the biological thing, which is the negativity bias. And there's a lot of evidence and research behind human beings and our brains having an automatic negativity bias. Rick Hansen talks a lot about this, but even before him, you know, you can look at someone like John Cacioppo, who's at University of Chicago, who did a study where he put people in front of a, and I'll get to the depression in a moment, where he put people in front of a screen and he showed them a few different images and he hooked them up to brain scanning machines, and he showed one of an image of a woman smiling, let's say, another of an image of a cat run over by a car, another of an image of, you know, an empty dinner plate. And so, just examples. And what he found was that the people who, when they looked at the cat, showed about twice as much activity in their brain as when they looked at the woman smiling. And so what he came to is saying that the brain is far more reactive to negativity. There's a lot more activity that goes on in the brain when it comes to negativity than to positive experiences in our life. So you ask the question, you know, are we done evolving it? Are we not done evolving? And yeah, we're absolutely not done evolving. And I think that's the, at least in my theory of things. And we're in a place right now that's probably the beginning of a new evolutionary cycle, and with a lot of groups of humans, which is this evolutionary cycle of building a brain that's more aware and going to be more adaptive to how we deal with emotions, which is at the center of how our brain is automatically making decisions. And so with another example of that, by the way, John Gottman, anybody heard of him? Relationship people here? You know, what he does is he takes couples, and he's, for years now, he's slowed down their interactions, so he studies their kind of their micro-expressions, and he's done this, he practiced and repeated this so much that he's become kind of a master at it, so he can look at a couple, and after 5 minutes, with a certain amount of accuracy, statistical accuracy, tell you, and you may not want to go to him, tell you whether it's going to work out or not, because there's a very simple ratio that he's found, and this is, again, a generalization, so take it with a little bit of a grain of salt, but there's some other things show a lot of evidence towards this, which is that a relationship needs to have a 5-to-1 ratio of positive experiences to negative experiences for it to work out. So, so that just kind of backs up John Cacioppo's study, which is that, you know, because our brains are far stickier with negativity than positivity, because we need to, again, we're thousands of years of refined activity. We need to be aware of the negative and the danger to survive. That's the most fundamental thing. Before we're happy, we need to survive. So we need to be aware of the negative stuff that's out there. Barbara Fredrickson, those of you who are into positive psychology, have heard her name before. She's found that people who are happy or doing well in life have a 3-to-1 ratio of positive versus negative experiences in their life. Let's see if there's anything else. There's other ones that come to my mind later, but these are all kind of pointing to that automatic negativity bias that's there. It's fundamental. So when someone's really depressed, that may not be a time for them to be mindful. And I wrote a blog a while ago called The Great Art of Distraction, because mindfulness isn't just about doing a practice where we're bringing ourselves to the present moment. Mindfulness is also just, remember, fundamentally the noun awareness. I'm aware right now that I'm in a really bad spot. Like my mind is just like riddled with negative stuff. I believe it. I have a high degree of believability, a high degree of frequency. In my new book that I write around mindfulness and depression, I reformulated this acronym that was an acronym called ANTS, Automatic Negative Thoughts, to be gnats, negative automatic thoughts. And the reason because it's more like there's these thoughts just kind of flying in your face. And if any of you have been around gnats before and they're in your face, it's really distressing. And so, and you're just trying to swat them away all the time. So so awareness of being really that depressed, you might be aware enough to say, what's most important for me to pay attention to right now? What's the best thing for me right now? Doing a body scan practice or a various type of awareness practice where we're being aware of many things at once, just sitting in presence, may not be the best thing. In fact, that because they're so gripped by it, they're just likely to continue ruminating and being attached to this. So it might be a spiral down for them if they did some meditation type practices then. They might do things that more give them a sense of that are nourishing to them in their lives, or give them a sense of accomplishment, going back to kind of classic cognitive behavioral therapy in some ways. Some kind of activity to get them going, as many of us talk about, but giving them permission. Now, this doesn't mean they're failing mindfulness. This doesn't mean they're failing in some adaptive strategy that's really popular in the field of psychotherapy and medicine right now. This means that they're aware enough, they're using it. They're aware enough to choose what's the most adaptive thing for me to do right now. And sometimes it's to be distracted. The same thing for trauma, for the incarcerated youth. At times when you're so overwhelmed with feeling and emotion, you don't have the wherewithal to, well, let me just sit with this for a moment. Unless you have a tremendous amount of practice. If you have a tremendous amount of practice with it, maybe you can do that. But even people of 30, 40 years experience in doing meditation practices like this, who suffer from long-term depression, don't find that they want to sit in meditation, a lot of them, when they're feeling really, really depressed. And not that you need to want to do that, but not finding it as helpful sometimes. And so sometimes we have to know what's best for me in this moment. Yeah. Yeah, so when she said it's not just the feeling, the emotion, it's the label we put on it, the judgment in some way, or even just the label of noticing this is bad. Bad's kind of a judgment, rather than this is anger right here, this is sadness right here, or this is like grief, or this is heaviness. That's one kind of label. Another label is this is bad. So in classic Buddhist psychology, which a lot of this kind of stems from, there's the idea of the two arrows, which the first arrow is the pain. The pain, it's the hit, it's the sadness, it's the grief, it's the heaviness, it's the, you know, it's this anxiety, it's the panic that's there. That's the first arrow. Or maybe it's not even the panic yet, but the anxiety that's there. The second arrow is, this is bad. Something really dangerous about this here. Or, the second layer is the judgment that goes on top of it. Which comes back to, our number one bad habit, again, which is thinking. Yeah, so, you know, and we're... Human beings have this great cognitive capacity beyond any other animal out there, really, to think, you know, in ways that are constantly preparing, rehearsing, or rehashing. And so that, or even just labeling something with some kind of negative judgment in some way, amplifies it. There is a study out of 2007 by Matthew Lieberman and Naomi Eisenberger at a UCLA, which they had people in two different groups, and they had, some of you might have, wrote this in the book, but some of you might know this one, where they put people, and they showed them two different pictures. One is a picture of like a woman really afraid, like this. Another is a picture of a man really angry, like this. And underneath two of the pictures, it showed, and for one group, it showed Dick and Jane underneath their names. On the other group, it showed anger and fear. And when they hooked them up to brain scanning machines, I'm not sure if it was an EEG or an MRI, but when they hooked them up to it, what they found was the group that saw Dick and Jane showed an increased activity in the amygdala. So when we know with depression and anxiety and we see enlarged amygdalas, that's another, I guess, well, which came first, the chicken or the egg? Was the person born with an enlarged amygdala, or, you know, did it become enlarged over time? You know, maybe a little of both. And so, but one thing that we know is that we can actually grow certain areas of the brain. So anyway, with the group that showed fear and anger, they showed an increased activity in the prefrontal cortex and a reduced activity in the amygdala. And so why is this? When you're able to label something, not with a judgment, but with just what it is, which is a lot about what mindfulness initially, fundamentally, in a beginner's level, you know, is just doing. We're just kind of naming something that's there, not with the judgment, but just naming whatever it is first. Because when you do that, you can't help but get a little space from it. By labeling something, you get a little space from it. If I was to smack my face, so we'll use the gnats example. If I'm in the middle of the gnats, you know, I can't see what's going on. But if I get a little space from that, I go, oh, a cloud of gnats. I get a little space from it, so there's a little bit of perspective. If I say this is anger here, this is fear here, there's a little space between my awareness and the emotion itself. In that space is that choice point lies our opportunity to choose to respond to it or relate to it differently. That's where that possibility, growth, and freedom come from. So just by labeling something without the second arrow, but just with the first one, of just what's here right now, what's here, you'll notice in that brief, what was a stop practice that we did a few moments ago, stop, take a few deep breaths, observe, and proceed, you'll notice that the O of it was just naming our experience, emotions, the body, emotions, and thoughts. All it was doing was allowing us to get a little space from our experience. And for some people, that turns the volume down on their thinking. And that makes sense. So whose minds were wandering? You could out yourself. A couple honest people here. Okay, a few. Okay, a little more. They start creeping up. When people start doing that, it gives other people permission. So there was another study that I'll mention to you. It's a very important study. And sometimes when you talk about introducing this to clients, sometimes they like to hear studies. Not in any real technical way. Because if it's a study and it's science, well, then it increases believability. And if it increases believability, they're more likely to actually be open to trying something or being open to, or actually, again, placebo accounts for 15% of change in therapy. So even that could actually increase your chances of the person helping the person get better. So a study of 2011, Norman Farb and Zindel Siegel. Zindel Siegel is one of the founding guys who created mindfulness-based cognitive therapy for depression. And this was a study where they took people, and actually it's kind of funny because it's mindfulness-based cognitive therapy, but they put people through a mindfulness-based stress reduction program, and which was what mindfulness-based cognitive therapy is based on. It's a majority of it is mindfulness-based stress reduction. And they put people through this program, and what they did was they put one group through this program, and they did another group who didn't go through this program. It's just business as usual for them. And what they did was they put them in front of a few different 45-second movie clips. Now, who here has seen Terms of Endearment? A number of people. Good. Anybody seen The Champ? A few people? Okay. I know, Roger, you've seen those movies. And so these are two of the saddest movies that ever existed in our culture. They really are. If you really want to have a cathartic experience, just get rid of some of the grief or sadness that's there, or just got to let it out, just flip on one of these movies. Because the 45-second clip of Terms of Endearment was a mother watching her daughter die of cancer. The 45-second clip of The Champ was of a son watching his father dying after a boxing match. So, and then they showed a clip of like someone doing some wood cutting or something, which was just kind of a neutral one. That doesn't really matter. So what they found was that both groups, the one that went through the mindfulness training and the one that didn't go through the mindfulness training, showed the same perceived sadness. They both showed that they were really sad in watching these clips. The difference was with the mindfulness, the group that wasn't doing the mindfulness, they showed a statistically significant difference in the Beck depression inventory. So higher rates of depression in the Beck depression inventory. So that was interesting, but what does that mean? We don't know until they looked at the brain scans. And what they found was something really fascinating. They found that these two groups were using two completely different parts of their brains. The group that didn't do the mindfulness training showed increased activity in this area called the cortical midline, which a few years ago, Norman Farb, the chief investigator of that study, found that that's the area that is active when our minds are wandering, thinking about the past, thinking about the future. You know, worrying about something, rehashing something, whatever it is, that's what's happening when our mind is wandering. There's activity in that part of the brain. The group that did the mindfulness training showed activity in the more the somatosensory areas of the brain, the somatic, the body-oriented areas of the brain, including the insula, which some people have considered the seat of awareness in the brain. It's what connects, it's what sends messages from the lower areas of the higher areas saying that, hey, this is what's happening with your emotions and your body right now type of thing. And so increased activity in that part of the brain. So what did that mean to them? It meant to them the people that were doing the mindfulness training likely, when they felt the sadness, brought their attention to their bodies and actually allowed themselves to inquire or be with the feeling that was there. The people that didn't have the training just kind of thought about the movie clips and maybe reference parts of their life, different things, people dying in their life, or anticipated other people dying in their life. You know, we don't exactly know, but what we know is that when the mind was wandering, it was connected and correlated with the higher rating of the Beck depression inventory. The people that were able to be with their experience, lower rating of the Beck depression inventory. That was really fascinating. So why is that? When we talk about the depression loop, the stress loop, the anxiety cycle that's there, when it's panic, whatever it is, what do we need to fuel that? What does our brains need to fuel our emotional suffering? Talked a little about this earlier. So I guess it's a test. What does it need to fuel it? Where does the evidence come from? What's it doing when it's looking for it? It's thinking. Don't think. That's the message here. Okay, thank you very much. Just kidding. Okay. No, but it's thinking. And so, not that, thinking is a very general term. We can philosophically come up with a lot of arguments around this. But generally, that's kind of what it's doing. And so it needs the stories to fuel the emotional suffering. I'm not able to handle this. Or nothing's ever going to get better. Look at the trifecta of depression. No one can help me. It's never going to get better. It'll always be this way. Or whatever the trifecta is, right? And so it needs that to fuel it. And so that's our number one bad habit is thinking. And so in that study, what was happening was, when you take the thinking out, and you're able to be with the experience, I'm pointing to an imaginary board here. Thinking, sensations, emotions. When you're able to take the thinking out and just be with the feeling, it turned the volume down. When you're with the feeling, it turned the volume down on the thinking. So what did the study find? There's an inverse correlation between our ruminative mind and being with experience. Just think, if you're in a coffee shop, or you're wherever, you're drinking a nice cool glass of iced tea, and not that you drink that in a coffee shop necessarily, but some people might. Nice cool glass of iced tea, and you're really paying attention to the tea. Or like you were saying, you're really paying attention to washing the dishes. You can't be really worrying or ruminating on past events at a high volume at the same time. It might be still filtering in the background. But if you're really worrying about the future or the past or some kind of thing in the past, you can't be present at the same time. So in other words, the iced tea is gone. You haven't even tasted it, or barely. And so there's actually an inverse correlation in those parts. So when one volume is up, the other volume is down. Turn another volume up, the other volume turns down. A good way of relating it to clients. Because that's just a very simple way of understanding that. And then you can give them an experience. If you have some practice with that. A stop practice is an easy one, or again, it's good to kind of have some experience with that. Throughout the Now Effect, there's 14 short videos that you have access to kind of give yourself and other people experience with a variety of different practices. So that's one of the things I wanted to really tap on. Now for children, just want to kind of note this. For children, you have to be a little more imaginative, a little more creative in some ways. And so some ways to kind of introduce that ability of being with experience is just to, and some people with children, they take them on walks, or they bring in nature and they ask them to actually feel the nature that's there, a leaf or a ball, and they ask them to describe the experience. You can give them a something to taste, like in the classic, in the beginning of mindfulness-based stress reduction, there's a raisin eating practice that's there. Anyone done that raisin eating practice before? I did that practice, I've done that practice many, many, many times. One time I was doing it with a group, and this guy was there, and he said, my whole, by the way, so those of you who haven't done it, you're just taking a raisin or a piece of food, and you're bringing your senses to it. So you're looking at it, the different colors and shapes of it, you're imagining this is the first time you've ever done this before, you're smelling it for the first time, you're hearing it, you're looking at it again, you're putting it in your mouth, you're tasting it, and so you're taking a long time to eat this physical food, whatever it is. Some people come out of it saying, like, wow, I can't believe it, a raisin or a cranberry or chocolate or whatever it was. I've never imagined it being so fulfilling, just a single one. Wow, I might eat less if I do this. All these different things. My mind was thinking about all these things or whatever. And so one guy I was doing it with said, my whole life I've been shoveling raisins in my mouth. And it's only now I realize I don't even like raisins. And so when we're living on routine, Abraham Joshua Heschel is a rabbi and a peace activist, and he has a great quote that said, life is routine and routine is resistance to wonder. Life is routine and routine is resistance to wonder. So you have to ask, what are some of the reasons this doesn't come so easy? The brain is wired to make things routine so we can handle more and more complex tasks. So that's another reason besides the negativity bias. And so we're wired to miss out on things. And you all have experiences with this. You put up a new piece of art in your house, it looks wonderful the first day, three, four, and then you just forget about it. Or you walk around a block of a new neighborhood, you see a great rose, whatever it is, it's a great rose again. Some people get to stick with that rose, but most of us will just continue, we'll start to just walk by it because the brain wants to think about other things now. It's got more complex things to think about. And so we're wired towards routine. And so we miss out on the positive experiences, which we'll get to in a moment, that is so important to start to incline our minds toward, to start to savor, to start to build those networks in the brain so that we can start naturally inclining more towards them. Yeah. How do you make, yeah, so the question, she said in what she liked about in the book and what she resonated with in her life was that you can have an experience, an insight, something fantastic. You get this from reading a book too, or you get this from watching a movie, or you get this from a conversation with your friend, or something happens in therapy. You have this great insight, but the insight just kind of falls away eventually because the brain is also wired to react. The brain's really reactive. And it reacts with cues. So in therapy or in a book or something like that, you're engrossed in an environment where there's certain cues that are kind of allowing for these states of mind to be elevated maybe in some way or kind of insights to happen. But then you go into your regular life, regular friends, back to your work environment, same route to work every day, and the same cues are there and they're not cueing that insight anymore. So we're like 95% reactive in our day-to-day. We don't have to think about what we're doing. It's really a good thing in a lot of ways, and other ways it's hindering. So the work is, how do you take that insight and savor it, linger with it a little longer? I think that's the key. The key in the practice of this is how do you linger, if it's an insight or some kind of positive experience like this, how do you intentionally set the intention to, and we'll get to this in a little bit, to linger with it? So that the brain, it gets to get stamped in there a little bit more. The way I understand perception is by our memories. Again, I see something, it comes in through my eyes or ears or any of my senses, it's referenced with all my memories, emotional memories are more salient, and I mean they get more play in the reference, and it spits out a perception of what's happening in this present moment or how I should react or respond to things. If I have a moment that's lingered longer, in my mind, what we're doing is we're expanding the footprint of that memory. And so it's more likely to get referenced. If we have many of those, it's more likely to get referenced to our automatic reactivity. So it's not as if I think in psychology, sometimes we get a little confused because we say, well, there's reacting and there's responding. Reacting is when we're just kind of doing things automatically. That's what kind of leads to our stress, anxiety, depression, addiction, trauma, this type of stuff. Then there's responding, where we're more intentional, we're choosing to do something. Reactivity is not a bad thing. We're going to be reactive most of the time. We want to wire a healthier reactivity. And one way of doing that by finding, let's say, an insight or a resonance with something in the book, for example, is to see if you can recall that, this is a practice to do with clients, to recall that memory or that insight, that thought, and see if you can get the felt experience of it and allow it to linger a little longer. Allow it to linger a little longer, expanding the footprint of memory in your mind and making it, connecting it with a more emotional, some kind of more emotional experience, which we know gets more play in our referencing. So we're starting to kind of wire a healthier type of reactivity. That play into that a little bit? Okay, good. Yeah. So I want to read a poem that your question reminded me of, which is a poem about how change happens. And this is... those of you who have this, is in the Mind Trap section of The Now Effect. It's a great poem by Portia Nelson called Five Short Chapters. Who's heard of this poem? A couple people. So here it is, and see if this resonates with you about how change happens with just anything in your life. So five short chapters. Chapter one, I walk down the street. There is a deep hole in the sidewalk. I fall in. I am lost. I am helpless. It isn't my fault. It takes forever to find a way out. Chapter two, I walk down the same street. There is a deep hole in the sidewalk. I pretend I don't see it. I fall in again. I can't believe I'm in the same place, but it isn't my fault. It still takes a long time to get out. Chapter 3, I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I see it is there. I still fall in. It's a habit. My eyes are open. I know where I am. It's my fault. I get out immediately. Chapter 4, I walk down the same street. There is a deep hole in the sidewalk. I walk around it. Chapter 4, I walk down another street. Chapter 5, sorry, I walk down another street. Walk down another street. So this is how it happens. So when we're talking about seeing that insight, having that insight for a moment, that's good. A seed is planted. How do we, and a great Vietnamese Buddhist monk named Thich Nhat Hanh talks about watering seeds. So there's all these different metaphors for our brain's almost a metaphor in some way, the way we talk about it. But what seeds are we watering? That's what's going to become more automatic. So are we watering the seeds of suffering in the things that we're doing, in the way that we're thinking, in the way we're paying attention? Or are we watering the seeds of change? Are we watering the seeds of more positive experiences? Are we watering the seeds of insight? That's the garden that grows in our mind. And that's what makes things more automatic. So what seeds are we watering? So with the insight, when we have insights, when we have good things that happen, you talk about in therapy, we talk about fanning the flame, right? You've heard that expression before, right? Or maybe you haven't. If you haven't, it's an expression. Fanning the flame, another metaphor. But what seeds are we watering? And so when we have these positive experiences, one thing that's new in therapy, it's come out of positive psychology maybe, but is being studied more in a variety of areas, is what does it do to our brain to amplify or fan the flame of or water the seeds of or linger in some of our positive experiences that are there, our insights that are there? What kind of neuroplastic changes does it make in the brain? And this is what's just kind of starting to be studied more. Because, of course, many of us know it's been a disease model for a really long time, so we know the atrophy that happens, or we know the correlation, the differences. For example, with people who are depressed, smaller prefrontal cortex, smaller mass in prefrontal cortex, smaller hippocampus, which is involved with learning, memory, and also tells us what's an appropriate context to express things in. I feel safe at home, that's part of the hippocampus maybe, or I go to work and I get really aggressive in anger. That's a little hippocampus misfire, you know, in some way. We also know that the amygdala is enlarged in people who are depressed. So I mean, or even anxious over long periods of time. So we know that there's correlations. What kind of changes are being made from this? And this is just beginning to be studied. My guess is because we know that what you practice and repeat over time actually makes neuronal changes in the brain, that we're going to start seeing that there's a lot of efficacy and there's a lot of reason for starting to advance a therapy that has people linger in and do specific practices that promote healthier states of mind, and even to undercut some of the unhealthier states of mind. Again, in adolescence, it's a very quick pruning that happens in the brain. But even as adults, there's still pruning that happens in the brain, and there's other neuronal changes and networks that are built from different new experiences that we have. Yeah?
I think one of the challenges I find, I don't work a lot with adolescents, is just that for people, I think, in our generation who have the disconnect from computers and smartphones, so we know what it's like before and we know what it's like now. But it seems to be this constant state of being in that smartphone and in that instant and reactive need. So sometimes I find it difficult to even slow things down or take time. It's really just like, I want it now.
Yes.
And it's not just adolescents, it's not fair to put that on them, but I experience that a little bit more, I think, only because there's no experiencing what it's like not to have a computer or a smartphone or, you know, having instantaneous information or access or whatever. And so
you're describing, what she's saying is that you're finding now, actually, even not just adolescents, but in your generation, that you're noticing changes in the way you're automatically paying attention because of technology, because of the introduction of technology.
Or not paying attention
to the introduction of technology. I mean, who here has a difficult time really getting through a long book? Okay, if I asked you that 30 years ago, that would be very different hands going up in here. And so you're talking about an experience of likely neuroplastic changes going on in your brain, in all of our brains, because of what we're practicing and repeating now over time. And so we are going through a cultural and societal shift and neurological shift, and maybe this is part of our devolution or evolution, you know, in some way. And there's those people that would argue that before books ever came into play, we were a fairly distracted culture. And we didn't pay attention to things for long periods of time, practice over time. And it's only because of the book that we, as a culture, change to being able to pay attention to things for long periods of time, throughout time. Otherwise, before that, we were distracted because we had snippets of things then too. Short stories people would tell. They wouldn't stand in long periods of time. Nicholas Carr wrote a book called The Shallows that speaks to that. For those of you familiar with that, if you haven't. But this is, I think this is fascinating, the way technology is changing our brains and our culture and society. Yeah. She said, I don't think Western culture is conducive to mindfulness because we're constantly multitasking. It's part of our culture. It's in our companies. It's rewarded. All this stuff. And what I would say is this. Just because that's our way of being, our automatic way of being, doesn't mean that new introductions of things don't change that. New introductions of things have constantly been resisted over time. I mean, just look at any kind of revolution of any kind. It's always like the underdog, no, we don't want that type of thing. And then what happens is change starts to happen as it starts to seep in. And there's a tremendous amount, at least I'm kind of in it a bit because I'm surrounded, you know, with it in a lot of ways. But I'm seeing a tremendous amount of changes that are going on individually, culturally, politically, economically, because of the advent, and not that mindfulness is a panacea, and this is what we'll get to right now, that mindfulness isn't all there is, but that's just starting to seep in. It's a slow change. We're dealing with a very large organism here of the world, or of, you know, but when we bring it back to the person in therapy, still very large in a lot of ways, because depending on the trauma and depending on where the person's at, we have to meet them where they're at, depending on that, it might be very slow change. That's okay. One of the core qualities of mindfulness, just to bring it back to this, is patience. Is developing that virtue. And not that you say to someone, well, you know, hey, patience is a virtue. You know, you got to sit with this depression for a while. You know, your trauma is going to be around for a while. But you know, sometimes that gives someone permission. But that they experience a sense of patience with it as they're able to be with it. Depending on where they're at. If they're on the end of the spectrum where they're kind of flipping their lid, you know, they're not. That may not be the best time for that. But being able to even dip their pinky toe into an emotion, a feeling, gives them a new experience. But again, mindfulness isn't all there is. Mindfulness can change our relationship to it, allow us to get a little space, widen that space between the stimulus and response, allow us to change our relationship to things. But at times, it's not enough. It's not enough. That's why mindfulness is not a panacea. It's not going to change everything. It's not, but awareness is where it begins. So the other thing that happens when someone is in emotional pain or suffering, whether it's stress, anxiety, depression, trauma, or addiction, is they need something else. And any of you who've done therapy, like inner child work, you know, have a sense of this. So if someone's dealing with who's done like inner child work here, like psychodynamic kind of stuff? Okay, someone's sensing that someone's in a bad place, and they're able to get in touch with that inner child. What's the question that you might ask them? To ask that child, or maybe to what's the question to elicit some kind of what? In what way do they want to relate to that child? What kind of question? What comes up for you? What do you need? Okay, we'll just stop there. What do I need right now? You need to be aware, in a space of awareness, to even acknowledge that you're suffering in a moment, and to be able to drop the question in, what do I need right now? What do you need right now, this child? What do I need right now? And in doing that, what you're doing is you're doing something very interesting. You're acknowledging what's happening, so you're understanding that part of you, and you're also caring. You care enough to ask the question, what do I need? The two pillars of acceptance is understanding and caring. if you were sitting in a circle of people who you felt all understood you and cared about you, how would you feel? Great. Someone said, that's my funeral. When I was saying that to a group recently, someone said, oh, that's my funeral. She's a funny lady. But you'd feel accepted. Carl Rogers says, you're probably familiar with that guy. Carl Rogers says, it wasn't until I accepted myself just as I was that I was free to change. You know that quote? Okay. It wasn't until I accepted myself just as I was that I was free to change. But the two pillars of acceptance is understanding and caring. So mindfulness, some people say, is a bare awareness of what's here. Other people who are more psychologically oriented say, well, it's more of a kind attention. It's kind of a caring attention. But we need to dissect that a little bit because we need to add in a couple other elements. What do I need implies that I actually care. So we're paying attention in a particular way with kind of a more caring type of attention. And this speaks to the new, not really new, sorry, been around for quite a long time, but it's being studied more and more in the advent of self-compassion and compassion. So here's two critical elements as therapists we can really build on for ourselves, our own self-care. By the way, the medical doctors and also therapists are oftentimes notorious for not following their own advice. There's a great pin that says, take my advice, I'm not using it. And so, you know, they're notorious for not taking care of it. So self-care, there's another workshop here that was going on earlier or maybe so around self-care happening right now? Okay, happening. Thank you for choosing to be here. Okay, so, but notorious for self-care. So this is really about taking care of ourselves, understanding what we need, and it starts with awareness. So what's self-compassion? Self-compassion, let me explain to you. There's a guy named Matthew Ricard. Anybody heard of that guy? Nobody? Okay, so here's a guy. He was, years ago, he was went to the Pasteur Institute in France, I think, and he was an engineer, some kind of engineer of some kind, and he got his PhD in bioengineering or something like that, and after he got his PhD, he said, the hell with this, and he went to the Himalayas to go meditate. And so, and he became really good friends with the Dalai Lama and part of his inner circle, and he was brought in around 2003, I think, that he was brought with a bunch of other monks to Richie Davidson's lab at the University of Wisconsin to kind of study what the heck is going on with these guys' brains, people who have a lot of practice in mindfulness. And so what he found was, initially he found that when this guy, Matthew Ricard, was doing what's called a loving kindness practice, which is, those of you familiar with that, loving kindness practice, some of you shake your heads, and I'm guessing that there's some people who are not. Loving kindness practice is a practice where you're getting in touch with certain phrases that you might think are well wishes for somebody, friendly wishes. May you be happy, may you be healthy, body and mind, may you feel safe, may you be free from fear, things that you'd like. So they're kind of general. So you're wishing it for another person, you're wishing it for yourself, different ways to do it, wishing it for a whole group of people, someone who's difficult. You go through the systematic process. What he found when he did this, and they measured his brain, he had this massive left prefrontal shift in the prefrontal cortex. What massive left shift. This part of our brain has been, in an earlier research, Richie Davidson, who's at pretty much at the forefront of studying mindfulness in the brain and compassion, you know, all this stuff for years. And this part is known to light up when we're feeling well, when we're feeling happy, when we're feeling like things are safe, in a lot of ways. This right side right here of the prefrontal is lights up when we're feeling depressed, when we're feeling anxious, more kind of, you might consider negative emotions without trying to put that. I used to say positive, negative emotions, then I said comfortable and uncomfortable emotions because I wanted to try and get away from the label of judgment. But then I realized that love is an uncomfortable emotion for a lot of people, so you can't really say comfortable, uncomfortable. But anyway, more of the kind of negative, difficult emotions, this area kind of lights up, the right prefrontal. So then he had this massive shift, right? So, which is also attributed to resiliency. If you're feeling better, if you're walking down the street and you're feeling really good and someone snubs you, you probably think, what the hell's wrong with them? You know, or screw you, or whatever, you know. You're walking down the street, you're feeling really lousy, you're feeling insecure, someone snubs you, you say, what did I do wrong? So the event's the same, interpretation is different. That's how we know thoughts aren't facts. If they were, they would all, the thought would always be the same, that the event would be the same thought connected to the same event. So, great phrase, by the way, that clients really love, thoughts aren't facts. That really sticks with them, by the way. And so I have a whole chapter on that in the Now Effect, also coming from mindfulness-based cognitive therapy. It's in the Mindful Way Through Depression. Where was I going with that? So anyway, self-compassion. Yeah. This is what happens when you have a 2- and 4-year-old, by the way. Rhett Davidson, they brought magic card, got it. Okay, great. That's what I needed that line. So they showed this massive prefrontal shift. So anyway, and they've shown that now with lay people, not just some guy who's had 40,000 hours of meditation experience. They showed that with people just in the regular bioengineering company that they had this left prefrontal shift to while doing some of the mindfulness practices just at all. But what was most interesting is when they brought this guy, Matthew Ricard, over to San Francisco to a lab there, and they had him watch a couple films. One was a film of an arm becoming amputated, and he showed a lot of disgust to that film. Another was a film of, they showed the whole person, a burn victim, who was getting his skin peeled off. So I just studying the faces that are out there right now, like that, right? He showed something different. He showed that left prefrontal shift again, and he showed he had an automatic feeling of compassion. This is what he had, because he's had a lot of practice in this, or maybe he's naturally inclined towards it. My guess has something to do with the practice. But he showed something that a lot of people might not show. So when we're talking about our stress, anxiety, depression, trauma, shame that comes from falling into addictive habits, what would be different if that second arrow that I talked about earlier, instead of that being like, ah, can't believe this happened, I'll never get this right, or this happened, I'm such a terrible person, or whatever it is. Instead of that was a feeling of self-compassion, which was understanding what just happened and caring about yourself. That feeling of acceptance, an inclination towards doing something that's caring about yourself, if that started to come more naturally as being paired with those difficult moments, what would be different with ourselves? What would be different with our clients? What would really be different? Everything. What do you mean? Say more about that. Everything.
The perception on these things would shift, like you were talking about earlier, with how we see events. If you're walking down the street and somebody's nudging, same thing. If you are more compassionate with yourself and you're more accepting of yourself, your perception of the world around you is going to be different.
So your perception.
Totally, going to be different.
Totally different. Your perception will be totally different, which changes your experience entirely. Changes how you react to people, behavior of people, react to ourselves, behave with ourselves. So instead of spiraling down, what happens is you spiral, and it slows down maybe as you spiral, and then it starts to kind of even out. So you don't pop up automatically, but it starts to kind of even out a little bit. So you're traveling more of those difficult moments with greater grace and awareness in some way, able to lift up a little sooner. So it impacts our resiliency. It impacts our resiliency. So that's some of the, I guess, the neuroscience around it. Those of you who have your own experience with conditioning certain types of responses to grief, maybe. This has been shown with grief, too. People have gone through tremendous loss. And it's really different to spiral around, I'm never going to find my partner again or my child or whatever it is, and versus understanding that this grief is here and being able to be with it with a sense of understanding and caring and having that happen more automatically. Again, what we're learning about the brain is that what we intentionally practice and repeat starts to become more automatic. So for those of you who work with children, so the child one, that loving kindness practice, you can just call it friendly wishes. And you ask them to, what kind of friendly wishes would you wish for your friends? What kind of friendly, you could do this with adults too, by the way. It doesn't have to be kids. What kind of friendly wishes, would you wish those same friendly wishes for yourself? What's it like to practice wishing friendly wishes? What do you notice? You know, so you could do that with kids, too, at the same time. It doesn't have to be just adults. So this is like real research that's kind of showing this type of experience shifting happening that comes with compassion and self-compassion. By the way, also, Barbara Fredrickson, again, who some of you know, created that broaden and build theory I mentioned earlier from positive psychology. She had people go through, this was just last year, a loving kindness practice, which was, again, a practice of just kind of getting at it. By the way, well, I'll segue in a moment. But and what she found was those who went through that showed not only increased positive emotions that they experienced, but they experienced greater social support, which was fascinating because they did it on their own. But they experienced greater social support partly because part of the practice is to wish this for other people. It's a systematic way. So what are you doing? You're expanding connection, a feeling of connection. You're practicing expanding a feeling of connection. When they brought a group to Harvard to play piano and measured their brains and found growth in the motor cortex by playing piano, and they brought another group in to just imagine playing that score over time and show the same growth in the motor cortex, we're finding that just visualizations have a real neurological impact. So if you have someone just visualizing the loving kindness practice, you would assume you're visualizing, again, sending wishes, systematic, and there's a video of it, and both of these books have that practice, by the way. But you're visualizing this, you're getting out of yourself. And let me explain how this works in parenting. Who here is a parent? A few people. Okay, you can do this with the other difficult people in your life, not just your kids. And so, if you're not a parent, you could do this. But here's a personal example for me. I have a 4 and 2-year-old who sometimes are kind of difficult. Both boys. Don't want to go to bed, you know, that kind of stuff. And so, sometimes there's nothing you can do, in my experience, but notice your tension rising. Notice that really distressed experience that you get, the clenched teeth, the tense shoulders. Nothing you can do but and continue to direct in the way that you're directing. And then when you're there and you're still noticing how difficult it is, you can be mindful of that. That's the first step, so you're aware of it. Try not to judge yourself for it. But what I do as an informal practice is I put my hand on my heart because it's a gesture. I know my brain knows it associates with this being a gesture of caring, because the heart is connected with caring. My hand on my heart, and I say to myself, this is really hard. So I first acknowledge it. This is really hard right now. And so I'm combining an acknowledgement of it with caring about myself. And then I think of all the other parents, maybe even in that moment, who are having a very similar experience to me. And all the other people in the world who have had throughout generations this very same experience, or very similar anyway. And that completely shifts the experience for me, because all of a sudden I'm not so alone anymore. Now I'm connected. So what if you could, through visualization or practice, grow certain networks in your brain that facilitated an automatic feeling of feeling more connected? What's emotional suffering? Or let me say this, rather than emotional suffering, what's mental dis-ease? It's a feeling of disconnection. Trauma, disassociation sometimes, even though it's a healthy coping habit at times, is a real disconnection. So, So she says this is what the brain does in moments of distress or trauma. It disconnects from itself. There's a feeling of incoherence amongst the brain that's kind of going on right there. And so what we're doing is we're practicing connection. We're practicing allowing that to become more automatic to us. And Dr. Gary Schwartz had a great quote. It says, unawareness leads to disconnection. Disconnection leads to imbalance. Unawareness leads to disconnection. Disconnection leads to imbalance. Awareness leads to connection. Connection leads to balance. Obviously, this is a general thing. Awareness leads to connection. Connection leads to balance. So we want to facilitate feeling more connected. You can ask anybody or a lot of people who are feeling, you know, any kind of emotional distress, it's a real feeling of disconnection. So we're facilitating connection so that it comes to us more automatically and we can kind of rise in that state of resiliency. Any questions that are coming up? Okay. All right. So let me just see. I'm going to do just to give you a quick, quick question, a question. Yeah. Yeah. Well, she said for those of you who couldn't hear, she said she has a clients who have a long pattern disassociating, and they feel really comfortable in that because it's been with them for so long and also served them in a lot of ways, is my guess. And it's not something they really want to let go of, because my guess is there's an underlying fear that, you know, what will be there, the uncertainty that will be there, you know, if they do. But there might not even be that awareness. It might just be that this is really, I just have a lot of fear around kind of letting go. And so I might ask them, without having to go into a long meditation practice, you know, what's the physical experience? Can you describe, when I'm talking about grounding, feeling my feet on the floor, and can you feel the sensation, your feet are kind of wringing your hands, can you feel that sensation? And if fear rises, can you describe to me a sensation in your body that's happening around that? Describing, so not asking them to go inward, but describing. People who suffer from severe trauma, so this kind of touches on a very important point, which is there's a danger to this practice if you're using it incorrectly. And so people who are unstable in the moment, you don't want them to go inward, really, and explore their emotional experience. That doesn't mean they can't be mindful. You can use practices that allow them to go outward. So they're just listening to sounds, or maybe they're describing sights to you, their experience. A loving kindness practice at times can be a good practice because it has words to it. It's not, they're not alone with their experience. There's words that are kind of, that they're reciting. So there's something grounding to kind of grab onto. You can also do a practice with people who are disassociating called a mountain meditation, which you can find online, the transcription to that, which is just having them visualize be a mountain, and then the various seasons that are coming and going, but the mountain remains the same, so they get to maybe experience a sense of stability that's there that they can always access, that's been there all the time, but maybe they need that guidance to experience. These are just some examples of some kind of outward, or if they're going to go inward, it has to be something that is not like an open awareness mindfulness practice where they're exploring their experience. It's something that's creating either outward stability or guiding them with kind of a guided visualization of some kind, I would say. Yeah. And also just wanted to touch on the incarcerated youth. So with incarcerated youth also, you have to use, and I don't have as much experience with that except for people who I've seen who have come to my private practice, but I haven't gone and work in incarcerated youth center. But from what I understand from people I've spoken to who do, you have to use, as we know, psychotherapy, the language that's there. So, you know, it's about kind of standing in a strong stance and feeling that stance of strength that's there in some way. So maybe you're using the value of being strong and feeling that. So you can be mindful and standing in a certain strong type of stance and feeling the sensations in your body while doing that, the grounding sensations, giving them the experience of being present, but in a way that's connecting to what the value is that's there. I mean, we all kind of value strength in some way, but you know, we got to meet people where they're at, and we just apply the present moment with whatever is their value is helps with connecting. And you'd be surprised. There's a organization here called Against the Stream, which some of you who might have heard of before, Noah Levine started, and it's in Santa Monica, it's in Hollywood, and there's a lot of people who come there, who come from an incarcerated background at times. I mean, it's a huge mix of people from all different kind of strata and spectrums. But, you know, there's that background that initially draws, and people are really into it because it's about grounding. It's about focus. There's a value in that. There's strengths in that. And strengths, I think, is a key word with that. So, I'm aware of our time, so we have about 10 minutes left, right? Have that right? Yeah. I want to mention a story to you that's a client story that I think this applies to, coming back to compassion and self-compassion. I had a client who grew up in a very traumatic childhood. She lost her mother when she was young. Her father was basically absent. And when she was a little older, she got in a severe car accident, which left her with one leg shorter than the other. And so she had a lot of shame around this, so much so she could never really look at her leg. Never ever, for years, years and years, she could never look at her leg. And so this is not even her background, it's just around even the the trauma of the accident that happened and being kind of malformed. And one time we were working with, one of the things that we want to do in mindfulness and psychotherapy is initially sometimes work on concentration with somebody. So allowing them first to being able to concentrate on something and learning how to work with their mind when it goes off and kind of bringing it back and letting go of the judgment around that. And that's a metaphor for life. You have an intention to do something, it goes off. It's a lot more effective to just kind of note that and learn from it and come back than judge yourself or say this will never work for me or that kind of stuff. So this is focusing on something that's kind of a metaphor. Anyways, then we started to get to some other mindfulness practices, but then to some compassion practices. So I was leading her through a loving kindness practice because I was trying to amplify the positive, that nurturing heart inside of her. And when I lead these practices in session, I'm doing them with the person, but from time to time I'm also opening my eyes because I want to see what's happening with the person in front of me. And at times I'll even interrupt them and ask them what their experience is. And I see this tear coming from her eye, and I say, "What's happening for you?" And she's been wishing other people well, to be happy, to be healthy, to be free from fear. She kind of brings it back to herself. She has her hand on her heart while she's doing this, and the tear comes down, and she looks down at her ankle. That's the first time she's ever done that. And she said, "You know what I went through? That was really awful." That's the first time she said that. That was really awful. Something opened up her heart. Something cracked that open where she could be with the experience. "That was really awful," she said. And she looked down. She goes, "It's the first time I've been able to experience what I've read about and talked about, that feeling of self-compassion. It's the first time I got to experience that sense." And it started with, "That was really awful." And it happened through kind of a systematic way of her being able to not just be with herself, but being able to incline her mind by starting with other people, but what she wishes with other people, towards herself and bringing it on herself, about inclining her mind to actually wishing herself well. That she could actually do this, but it has to get in touch with the heart. You have to get in touch with the heart to do that. It's a different part of the brain than just thinking about it. It's not a cognitive task. It's an emotional task. So it hits at the limbic system, where some of those memories are stored. Those emotional memories. So we're getting to the experiential network of the brain versus just the narrative network of the brain that's just storytelling. That's where the change starts to happen. And so that's the other advent of this when we're talking about change, mindfulness and psychotherapy or mindfulness and stress reduction or whatever it is. It's not just mindfulness. Mindfulness isn't enough. It's a really great starting point. Some people might say implicitly what comes up by being able to pay attention in a particular way is feelings of compassion and self-compassion. But I think in psychotherapy, it's really important to explicitly also at times allow that to come into play. And that loving kindness practice is explicit because there is an intention behind that, which is to try and cultivate the heart, connection with the heart in some way. That's the other part of this that, in my mind, the more research we do that with that, I think people that are actually practicing lingering more often in the positive experiences or even doing systematic practices like that will show kind of, we'll start to see as we start to get more refined technology, shifts in the brain that are making that more automatic for people. That's why Matthew Ricard had that automatic experience of compassion for the person who was getting his skin torn off, versus disgust, which would be most of our reactions in thinking about that. So ultimately, what we're doing in this is we're creating a wiser brain. That's what we're doing. We're creating a healthier type of reactivity that's reacting to our stress, anxiety, our impulses. Not that we're always going to catch them or change them in that moment, and we're never going to have them again, but when they occur, what would it be like if we were able to naturally react with greater awareness of their space while inclining our mind towards greater sense of caring about ourselves? Again, it wasn't until I accepted myself just as I was that I was free to change. You can't change anything until you accept the reality of what's here. Tara Brach wrote a great book, and I've since become close with her, around radical self-acceptance. Not that you want it to be here, but you have to accept the reality of it in order to create the change that we want to make. So we have 5 minutes left. I have some other things I can talk about, but in these 5 minutes, why don't we kind of go around and just say, what are five ways that you feel like you are or can kind of bring this more into your life, your practice, or with your clients? Why don't we do a little popcorn, see if we can get some wisdom from the audience a little bit, wisdom from you all. So the well wishes I feel for my clients in session, I rarely turn back on myself. So maybe it would be a great practice in between sessions. Sometimes we don't all have in between sessions because a lot of us aren't good at stopping So we kind of bleed one into the other. But even informally, you can kind of do that to yourself by putting your hand on your belly, maybe even in the session as a grounding type of experience, and saying to myself, if you're wishing well for them, allowing that to kind of filter for yourself as well. Yeah, or in between clients if you have the time. Yeah.
I wanted to ask about the kids, but I love the idea of the family wishes.
Yeah.
Bringing that into the room, because my little one just arrived from 9, so there's a sense of that you even know what they're feeling.
Yeah. Okay, so she says bringing the well wishes into the room for the kids, the friendly wishes, moments of friendliness. And also for kids, in order to make it imaginative, sometimes if you want to do kind of a breathing practice, a concentrated breathing practice, you might have them lie down on your couch or whatever it is, or on the floor, and put some kind of, help them bring in their favorite stuffed animal, little stuffed animal, something like that, put it on their belly and ask them to make it rise and fall. Now that's another thing. There's a lot of little kind of tricks to that are nice, bringing some play into it. And also with adults, we got to bring play into it. That's the part that we're missing a lot. So playfulness is a key aspect. In fact, one of the little chapters in the Now Effect that got taken out because my editor didn't think that people would be able to remember it, as I said, the key elements of mindfulness is play now. Play now. And what that stands for is the P stands for playfulness. Because ultimately, that's what we're doing. We're in a non-judgmental way, we're kind of adding, like, I'm trying to pay attention to this. That's my intention, but I kind of go off. Oh, it's like Jack Kornfield has this story of a dog kind of going off and peeing in the corner. It's like training a dog. You bring the dog back gently, and then it goes off and makes a mess over there. You bring it back. So our minds are kind of the same way. So we're kind of adding that. The L stands for love. It's a sense of loving, a caring to it, a warm-heartedness to it. The A stands for awareness or acceptance. Or allowing, even. Any of these are good. There's a sense of allowing. The Y stands for yoga. And I was just teaching at Kripalu, if any of you are aware of that place. If you aren't, first time I've ever been there, amazing place. Ridiculous. Yoga all day long, but also workshops and the great food. It's amazing. Kripalu. Kripalu. I'm not sure there's another place on the planet that's kind of exactly like this place. They're just a well-oiled machine in the way that they kind of work. Always great yoga teachers, too. The Y stands for yoga, and the reason it's in the definition initially, I said it's a connection of the mind body. But when I was at Kripalu, the reason that reminded me of that is there was a definition of yoga that said yoga is being aware of things just as they are, or something like that, or the now just as it is, or something like that. And I said, okay, that's a good one. N stands for non-judgmental, O stands for openness, and W stands for welcoming. And we don't have time to do this poem here, and some of you have heard this maybe, but The Guest House by Rumi is a good one to look up around the direction we're kind of trying to head. Not that we need to head in this direction, but his poem brings up an idea of welcoming what's here. Like as this body is just a guest house, and the emotions that come in are like guests that are coming into our house. They're already here, and we can just be with them and allow them to go as they will. The natural law in life is that all things come and go except for that law. So, right? And so, you know, we're playing with it. A good thing to bring up. Sometimes bringing poetry or bringing pictures into sessions with people can help them kind of connect with it. I sometimes bring up a picture of a child kind of crying. I have a good picture of a young girl crying, and it looks very authentic. And I say to clients, what do you notice when you see this? And they go, oh, a lot of people. Oh, it doesn't always hit that way, but a lot of people, oh, I go, what's that? They said, oh, I just feel for this person. I said, that's right. That's the feeling we want for yourself. That's it. Because rather than telling them, rather than being a cognitive experience, I want to kind of enter different parts of their brain. And so that gives them that. It's another thing that you can do. So I know we're out of time. Anyone have any questions? Yeah, you got a question back there. So he said, as a medical doctor, he sees probably tons of people, and so how do we screen for people who are mindfulness appropriate in some way? Is that a way of saying it? Well, I think anybody that has stress is a good start. And what I would say is, if someone's in a massively traumatic type of reaction, that wouldn't be a good time to have them enter into, like, let's say, a mindfulness-based stress reduction or mindfulness-based cognitive therapy or any kind of formal mindfulness program. Where they're doing long meditations. That's probably not a good one. If someone's really lost in their depression, like in the deep scale of 1 to 10, they're like at a 9 to 10, that's not a good time either, because again, earlier I had said there's at times a great art to distraction. And so, but you may plant seeds, and that might be okay. And we were talking about it a little earlier, sometimes you can get insight from a book, or you can get insight from hearing someone talk, or you can get insight from these types of things, which are seeds that get planted. But generally, it's if someone is also, you may be able to feel into this. If someone has like a real strong characterological issue. Trying to stay away from disorder, but if you know that may be worth kind of referring anyway, and just allowing the person who's leading it to a group or something to suss it out for themselves. You might give them that. That would be okay too. And anyway, you could always refer someone and have the leader, you know, whoever is leading, you know, any of the program that you're referring them to. So you give them that sense of this person that's just gone through a lot of trauma. Is this a good person for your group? Because different teachers will take on different people. But in general, someone who's really lost in their extreme emotional place, it depends on the person. But that may be a time not to refer as much. But again, that depends on the person. Yep. Any other questions? Yeah. Okay, so she said, well, people who are starting mindfulness have been practicing for a while, let's say meditation in particular, I think you're talking about, because there's formal and informal ways to bring this into our lives. Formal is when you set particular time aside and actually do a practice. Informal is when we just kind of wash the dishes or in the shower or noticing our negative thoughts and kind of bringing ourselves back, you know, that kind of stuff. And she said, at times when people are doing it, they hit a wall or they just don't want to do it. For me, if I'm working with somebody in that, I might ask them, I might normalize that and say, well, what's the experience? What do you notice, you know, even right now as you're talking about it? How does that feel physically? Is there any feeling in your body? Because almost like from a back door, I'm just kind of bringing them back here. There's a 15th century Indian poet named Kabir who said, wherever you are, that's the entry point. Wherever you are, that's the entry point. There's no perfect place to be. But you might say there might be a feeling of restlessness there, and so notice that feeling of restlessness. There's plenty of people who are have an intention of sitting for 15, 30 minutes, and about the 10-minute mark, their eyes open all the time. Eyes open. It's like had enough. What's that feeling? That edge? Can you ride that edge a little bit? That's interesting. And what does that mean towards other parts of your life where you might be hitting a wall, or you might feel restless at times, breaking through fear or moving through fears, that kind of stuff. But you want to bring them back to the feeling. What's that feeling when they're, that edge, when they're kind of knocking off into that place? And, you know, they can always come back. I mean, the wonderful thing about this practice is it's very forgiving. You can always begin again. Always. You're practicing, you're working with it, you go off for a week, 2 weeks, a month, a year, 2 years. You can always come back. Wherever you are, that's the entry point. You know, life is like that. That's kind of a beautiful thing. Even the judgments, you notice that, that's the entry point. And also, I just want to mention one last thing, I guess, which is the sense of uncertainty that comes up in therapy a lot with people and ourselves, even as therapists, feeling uncertain about our own skills, about our own ability to work with people, or even the people's feeling of uncertainty around their own abilities in some way. And there's two different mindsets we can have with this. One is an achievement mindset, where we're achieving certain states of mind, achieving health and well-being, achieving, you know, happiness, that kind of stuff. And that mindset, we got to suss out with ourselves and with people. That mindset sets us up to, on the other side of achievement, is failure. So sets us up kind of for a mind trap of falling into failure. Instead, we want to take a learning mindset to this, which is everything is about, the goal is to learn. And as if we take that goal, kids don't, when they're learning how to walk, when they fall, they don't go, "Oh, I'm never going to get this thing." You know, they're lucky. They don't maybe have that prefrontal cortex developed to really kind of do something like that. But they get up and they walk. We can learn a lot from our kids. You know, they get up and they say, "Oh, I fell. Okay, that hurt a little bit. Pain. Okay." And they get up and walk. And so in the same way, they're learning. We want to take a learning goal. What happened when I fell in that hole again, that pothole? Ah, I saw how that happened. I'm learning from it. I get out. Ah, there's the hole. I walk around it. But if we take a learning mindset, we're a lot more likely to get better and better at it than if we see it from an achievement-oriented thing. And that's what we got to work with ourselves and others around perfectionism. And someone here said, mindfulness isn't really suited to this culture because also it's an achievement-oriented culture. So we have to kind of back up, have a beginner's mind, take a fresh experience, and relearn maybe a new way of relating to stuff. And that's, by the way, that mindset stuff is has been really brought up by this woman, Carol Dweck, who started with kids and finds that kids are a lot more successful when they have a learning goal versus an achievement goal. And so that's the same for us. We're all kids anyway in some way. We've just kind of forgotten. Yeah. Carol Dweck, D-W-E-C-K. She wrote a book called Mindset. So listen, this has been great. Thank you so much for having me here.